evening. Welcome to our Candles by Candlelight, which, as the name says, we've got candles and we're going to have candles. So welcome. I said to Marjorie, I think about it during the week, that when you pick candles for a night like this, and you read out all the old favourites, like Hark the Herald Angels Sing, and Come All Ye Faithful, and Away in the Manger, folk get upset because that's what they come to sing. But I hope that there's enough here tonight to please everyone. That's an impossible task, of course, to please everyone. But I'm trying, very trying, honestly, Susan. This year is part of our Advent journey, and we've been lighting candles at our Sunday morning services. Candles of hope and peace and joy, and on Sunday we will light the candle of love. And we've been reflecting on these Advent themes over the last few weeks in our music, in our hymns and in our prayers. And so tonight we're actually going to take a wee bit of time to explore these themes a bit further in our reflections and poetry. After the service here, you're invited into the halls for tea and coffee and mince pies, as many as you would like, actually. So we look forward to seeing you there in the Tambright Hall, which if you go out to your right and just right around the corner and then through the door into the halls. Relax and enjoy the carols and enjoy the candlelight. There's a few carols tonight, I think. Seven, so we'll stand for the first and the last only, and you're welcome to sit for the rest of the carols. So we're going to stand to sing the first carol, if you go, 304, O Little Town of Bethlehem.
Thank you. noticed that many of the most popular children's and even adults' films and television programmes, such as The Wizard of Oz from many years ago, Hobbit, Harry Potter, even Doctor Who, include some parts that are really very, very scary. Parts that you wouldn't watch without your hand over your eyes, or, speaking personally, perhaps hiding behind the couch many years ago. In this Advent period, is it perhaps possible that the parts of the greatest story ever told might be similarly scary? For example, Matthew begins his story with the words, "Before she lived with Joseph, Mary was found with child." So we have an unmarried woman with child walking the streets of first century Bethlehem, hardly the once upon a time start to a story. In fact, Luke tells us of an earlier moment in which Mary was deeply troubled when she received the news that she could be with child. Is that an understatement, or is that an understatement? Joseph's unsurprising first reaction to his fiancée's news gives us a glimpse of how difficult the beginning of the Christmas story really was. Because even Joseph, who loved Mary, when he heard the news, was ready to run away. And Joseph needed a special message from an angel just to stay with Mary. "Do not be afraid," he was told. Probably none of us normally think of the Christmas story as one including risk or fear. We just want the wonder and magic of Christ's arrival that makes all our trouble disappear, a happy ending that we all know awaits us at the end of the story. And all of these wonderful joys are in the Christmas story, of course. But the entirety of the Christmas story should set us thinking. Are we ready to experience the risk that is inherent and an inescapable part of this joy? The Christmas Gospels are clear about this. The most wonderful things in our lives don't come without risk. Anyone with family must have felt fear and trepidation at the birth of their firstborn. This new life was undoubtedly the greatest miracle of their lives. But perhaps was it also a time of their deepest fear, the deepest fears of their lives. Would I be a good mother or a good father? What will my baby's life be like? A deep, deep sense of responsibility and risk, and perhaps some feelings of inadequacy, and at the same time, unbelievable feelings of hope and expectation. There is something deeply human about the Christmas story that unfolds in these coming days. Mary and Joseph, in the midst of being called to their vocation, feel, mingled with all the joy and hope, the weight of the risk. The end of the story is that when Joseph awoke, he took Mary into his home, followed by, and they gave the child the name Jesus, the name the angel had given him before he was conceived. And this was at the time when the risk felt greatest, and Mary and Joseph did not believe themselves up to the task. Mary, full of grace, was in fact up to the task. Joseph too found that he'd been given the grace to say yes, to take up his great part in the story. What are the most joyful events in your life? Think about them this week. Whatever they are, can I suggest that we're accompanied by some of the biggest risks you've taken in your life too? And for some reason you didn't run away. Maybe you hesitated and you had to search for a way to get back into the story. Whatever the case, the Christmas message is that the really great events of our lives involve risk, and that it's deeply human to feel afraid, or not good enough, or wanting to run away. But it's also part of being human, a person of faith and hope, that at some point God gives us the grace we need to take up our role in the story. At At some point, God enters our lives and helps us to take responsibility for the lives we are called to lead for others. Advent is a time of waiting and hope for the arrival of this grace. In a few days, Christmas will be upon us, and the greatest story we know will be told yet again. Let us pray in these final Advent days for the grace and strength to enter as fully as we can into the wonder, the risk, and all the hope of this story. Amen. Our second carol is page number 313, See in Yonder Manger Road.
Thank you.
of when you hear the word peace? Is it having a world free from fight and war? Or just living your life and feeling calm all the time? What does peace mean to us? It can mean many different things at different times in our lives. When we are young children, we probably don't look for peace as such. But teenagers, well, they never look for peace from parents. And parents, well, they will definitely look for peace from teenagers. Whatever the answer is, what is certain is that people do feel the desire to feel peace in their lives. How can we find that peace? What do we have to look for? I'd like to share this story with you. There was once a king who offered a prize to the artist who would paint the best picture of peace. Many artists tried. The king looked at all pictures, but there were only two he really liked, and he had to choose between them. One picture was of a calm lake. The lake was a perfect mirror for peaceful towering mountains all around it. Overhead there was a blue sky with fluffy white clouds. All who looked at this picture thought that it was a perfect picture of peace. The other picture had mountains in it too. However, these were rugged and bare, and above them was an angry sky from which rain fell and in which lightning played. Down the side of the mountain tumbled a foaming waterfall. This did not look peaceful at all. But when the king looked closely, he saw that behind the waterfall there was a tiny bush growing in a crack in the rock. And in that bush, a mother bird had built her nest. There, in the midst of the rush of angry water, sat the mother bird on her nest in perfect peace. Which picture do you think won the prize? The king chose the second picture, and the reason he picked it was, when he was explaining to the others, he said, "Peace does not mean to be in a place where there is no noise, no trouble, or no hard work. Peace means to be in the midst of all those things and still be calm in your heart. That is the real meaning of peace." Real peace is that state of mind, not the state of the surroundings. So how can we achieve that? In verse 27 of chapter 14 of the Gospel of John, it says, "Peace I leave with you, my peace I give you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not be afraid." The peace that he talks about here is a translation from the Hebrew word shalom, and this word is usually a common greeting given by Jews. And the word shalom doesn't mean the absence of troubles or worries. It refers to a deep sense of wholeness, which can also be translated in these days as wellness. Shalom can therefore be used to describe a personal, inward, and lasting peace. The peace that Jesus is talking about here is the inner peace or calmness in your heart, despite any troubles. It doesn't depend on your circumstances. It doesn't eradicate worries or anxieties. But inner peace gives you the ability to endure with strong confidence that God will see you through. And if we remember that as long as we trust God, then we can have peace in our hearts, no matter what is going on in our lives or in the world around us. When I was looking for inspiration for this reflection, I came across this short poem, which was written by a girl called April Torres,
who goes to an elementary school in America. And she wrote, "Peace doesn't hate. Peace always forgives. Peace has a purpose to love and cherish, to honour and smile, to laugh and play, and stay for a while." Which tied in very nicely with a quote from Mother Teresa, which was the very first thing I found when I was looking for this. And her quote says, "Peace begins with a smile." We will now sing hymn 324, Angels from the Realms of Glory.
Thank you.
religious turmoil, the birth of Jesus is met with songs of joy. Mary's joy as she learns she's going to be the mother of God. The angels announcing good tidings of great joy to the shepherds. Joy that is for everyone. We've reflected this evening on our Advent themes of hope and peace. And later we'll look at love. And actually there's no problem thinking of a God of hope. Or a God of peace and certainly a God of love. But sometimes you need reminded that our God is also a God of joy. Joy is not something that God brings with the birth of Jesus, but joy is who God is. God is joy. And we see that joy manifested in the life of Jesus. When we think about Jesus' ministry, it was full of joy. He was always scooping up children into his arms and embracing the stranger and the outcast, bringing joy to their lives. Jesus was the kind of person who so exuded joy that people invited him to weddings and wanted him to come and have dinner with them. In my mind's eye, when I think of Jesus and his disciples and Jesus teaching the crowds or Jesus healing people, there's always laughter and joy involved. So what about us? What about our joy? When I was in primary 7, not that long ago, I had a teacher whose name was Mr. Smith. So here's a warning for you teachers out there, what a responsibility you have, because you will inspire people and children will remember you and what you said to them right into their adulthood. Every morning when I came into Mr. Smith's class, he would sing to me one of the pop songs which was in the charts at the time, and I'm probably going to give away my age here. And that song was "I Was Born With a Smile on My Face" by Stephanie Decides. Anybody remember that? Yeah. And the reason that he would sing that to me, Mr. Smith, was that I was a very serious child, even at 11 or 12. At that time, there was plenty in my life. There was plenty going on in my life that was enough to be serious about, even for a small child. And so I didn't smile very much. And maybe I was a bit of a misery guts. And we all know people like that, of course. People maybe we even avoid because they tend to be people full of woe, full of worries, folk who are a bit melancholy. And maybe we're afraid that our sad disposition will bring us down, rob us of our happiness, steal our joy. And of course, we've got plenty of stuff going on in this world right now that should weigh us down and even depress us. But joy, deep joy, is different from happiness. Joy is not the same as happiness. And no one can steal our joy. We can be unhappy about many things. But joy can still be there. We can still have joy even if we're unhappy or worried. Because it comes from somewhere different. It comes from the knowledge that we are loved by God. That we are loved unconditionally by God. And that joy is essential to our spiritual life. Joy doesn't simply just happen to us. We have to choose joy. And we have to keep choosing joy every day. It has to be a mindset when we get up in the morning. Genuine joy that is in that place in the heart where love and expectation and affection and perfect peace all unite together to produce inexplicable joy. And of course it's a spiritual experience. So there are no words to adequately in the Lord always, but also to weep with those who weep. We remember that Jesus wept at the death of his friend Lazarus, and he wept out of compassion for the grief of others. So deep joy is not incompatible with deep sorrow. The sorrow that comes from acknowledging that things are not all right or as they should be in our own lives, in the lives of our family, and even in the life of our world. So we shouldn't be beating ourselves up when we cannot summon a smile on demand, or when we cannot hide our tears. But it's still possible to know joy even in difficult times. Joy doesn't need a smile in order to exist. Joy is in the heart, and happiness is on the face. Joy is of the soul, happiness is of the moment. Pursue happiness, of course, but choose joy, always. We sing again, 3-2-2, good Christians all rejoice, 3-2-2.
Our reading this evening is from Matthew's Gospel, Matthew chapter 1, reading verses 18 to 25. And you'll find this on page 965 of the Pew Bible. Matthew chapter 1, reading from verse 18. The birth of Jesus Christ. This is how the birth of Jesus Christ came about. His mother Mary was pledged to be married to Joseph. But before they came together, she was found to be with child through the Holy Spirit. Because Joseph, her husband, was a righteous man and did not want to expose her to public disgrace, he had in mind to divorce her quietly. But after he had considered this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, "Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins. All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had said through the prophet. The virgin will be with child and will give birth to a son, and he will call him Emmanuel, which means God with us. When Joseph woke up, he did what the angel of the Lord had commanded him and took Mary home as his wife. But he had no union with her until after she gave birth to a son, and he gave him the name Jesus. Amen. Our next carol is number 301, Hark the Herald Angels Sing.
Christmas dinner, or who you will be spending Christmas with, you have received this year. Yes. Let go of the frantic side of Christmas. Calm down. Take a breath and reflect on what's been good in 2022. You may be asking why I would ask you to reflect on this. Well, when you take a moment, sit calmly in stillness and peace and focus on positive things, more positive energy comes to us. I'm sure we've all had difficult times in the last year, but having a bit of positivity helps you look at these times on a more optimistic note and look forward to 2023. In the same way, and focusing on the love that arrived with Jesus Christ is a really good place to start. Let me round off with a poem, True Love. Love can always conquer whatever discord brings, and love can also cover a multitude of things. Don't you underestimate what love can ever do. For love is God eternal, and his love can renew. What is cold and lifeless now lost all hope and died? For love can breathe new meaning and give it back new life. Please don't give up on love when it seems that all is lost, for there is always hope if we prepare to pay the cost. For love is always worth it, no matter how much the price. For love will be much stronger when we trust in Jesus Christ. So let God have full reign. Let him live within your heart. Then you will know true love, for this he will impart. Let Jesus' love come down and affect you this Christmas. We will now sing number 316, Love Came Down at Christmas.
Christmas evening, bring us to our beds with with grateful thoughts, forgiving and forgiven. For Jesus' sake. Amen. We're coming close now to the end of our service tonight. Just a few adverts, a few intimations. This Sunday, Sunday the 18th at 11 o'clock here in Newton Church is our nativity. So our children will be leading a nativity angel's view. So you're very welcome to come to that. And if you want to come to that, you're also welcome to dress up a character from the nativity, whatever is your choice, angels, shepherds, wise men, Mary and Joseph, donkey, star, your choice. It'd be lovely to see you there. And we also have our watch night service next Saturday night, and it begins about 11:10. There'll be congregational singing of carols, and our service proper starts at 11:30. And it is a fairly short service, it's half an hour, 40 minutes. Christmas Day, we have a service, I should say that this, the Watch Night service is up in the Country Church in Panbride, not here, it's up in Panbride, the Watch Night service. And the Christmas morning service, again, it's a short service, about half an hour, here at 10:30, so that's a bit earlier. That's to let Marjorie home to get a turkey on. So, is that right? That's absolutely right. So, here at 10:30, you're welcome to come and wear your Christmas jumper and bring one of your Christmas presents. Nothing left for me to say tonight, really, but thank our worship team for the reflections and poetry, and for Joyce, who had to step in at the last moment, so thank you, Joyce. Thanks also to Marjorie for playing for us, and for the choir leading us in the carols. We stand to sing our final hymn. 306, O Come All Ye Faithful, and we're only singing verses 1 to 3. So verses 1 to 3 of 306, O Come All Ye Faithful. May God's angels guide you and keep you safe each day. And the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you this night and forevermore. Amen. Please be seated. Just a reminder, there's tea and coffee and mince pies galore next door and next door.